Hello, Lakers Nation. Welcome into the LakersNation.com podcast. I am Trevor Lane. Got a great show for you today. We're 10 games in to the NBA season, so we're going to take stock of where the Lakers are currently at. What have we learned about this team? What have we found out? What's changed from last season, and what is still the same? Lots of stuff to dive into there. We're going to talk about individual players. We'll talk about the way the team is playing. All of that, take an assessment of where they currently are right now. I'm also going to get into the mailbag to close out the show. So without further ado, let's dive in. Well, actually, with one more ado here, if you're not a subscriber yet to the YouTube channel, make sure you do hit that subscribe button and also check out our channel membership program so you can check out the perks that we offer there. Click that join button and don't forget to subscribe on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, wherever you listen to podcasts. Again, free. All you got to do is follow us over there if you are a podcast listener. All right. So right now, you look at the Lakers, 10 games in. They're 6-4. I'm not that upset with 6-4. Like, I feel pretty good about 6-4 right here. The only game, and I know there's probably a bunch of you right now saying, but Detroit. Yes, you should not lose a game to the Detroit Pistons. I talk about it all the time. The way you get in the NBA standings, and we'll look at those in just a minute, the way you get where you want to go in the NBA standings is by winning the games you are supposed to win. They didn't do that against the Detroit Pistons. Other than that, though, hard to be too upset here. Maybe you lucked out and you caught Philly at a time when they were incredibly injured, and so you win that game. It would have been a very difficult game had, you know, Joel Embiid, Paul George, Tyrese Maxey all been 100% healthy, but there's been a ton of injuries across the NBA already. It's absurd this season, so you know, it's just kind of the way things have gone. You beat Minnesota, Phoenix, and Sacramento, three very good teams to start the year. You dropped a game to Phoenix, so you're 1-1 against them. You lost to the Cavs. Everyone has lost to the Cavs. They're 12-0. Overall, I can't be too upset about 6-4 right now, just given what we know about this Lakers team. Let's take a quick peek at the standings, what that means for the Lakers, 6-4. God, as I'm scrolling past it, look at the East. This is ridiculous. If there was ever an argument for the NBA to do away with conferences and just seed 1 through 20 playoff and play in, this is it. I don't think it's going to be this bad all season, but the 3 seed in the East is the Pacers, and they're 5-5. There are 2 teams right now in the East, the Cavs and the Celtics, that have a winning record. The Orlando Magic are the 4 seed, and they're 5-6. Then look at the West. Just take a look. Look at the West. The Dallas Mavericks, who represented the West in the NBA Finals last season and probably got better over the summer, they're 5-5. They're the 11th seed in the West. That's the environment the Lakers are in. 500 basketball means you're not even making the play-in. We talk about unforgiving, and that's why in April we may be looking back at that Detroit game saying, man, wouldn't have been nice if the Lakers had got that one. Unforgiving, the Western Conference. But the Lakers currently the 7th seed. Maybe that doesn't feel great because that's where they finished last year too, but the 7th seed right now with the 6-4 record. Again, it's very, very early, but still, that's where the Lakers currently sit. Now, what do we know about this team? What have we found out? Well, a lot of it is really kind of been the same when we get into the statistical production of the team. So, for example, they're not a high-volume three-point shooting team. That was the case last year. They're not a high-volume team. So J.J. Redick wanted the team to be better shooting the ball from three, wanted to take more threes, which made sense last year because they were legitimately a good three-point shooting team last season. That has not happened. You take a look at the three-point attempts for the Lakers so far this year. Per game, three-point attempts, the Lakers 26th in the NBA. They're taking about one more three per game than they did last season, and that's with that game in Memphis with no Anthony Davis when the Lakers were just letting it fly. I want to say they shot like 48 threes, something in that game. So that's even with that game on their record. They're not, the three-point volume increase has not happened. The offensive rebounding, It's improved a little bit. That was another big area. JJ Redick talked a lot about corner crashers, wanting Max Christie to crash from the corner. We'll talk more about him in a minute. Wanting Rui Hachimura to crash from the corner, Cam Reddish inheriting that role now. It hasn't amounted to a lot more offensive rebounds per game. They're right now ranked 26th in the NBA in offensive rebounds per game. Last season, Darvin Ham effectively punted offensive rebounds and said, please, everybody try to get back on defense instead. It did not work. They were a terrible transition defensive team, and that's continued as well. In fact, when you go and you take a peek at points scored, fast break points given up, the Lakers, once again, at the bottom, well, almost 29th in the NBA in opponents' fast break points scored. So that hasn't changed. The good thing, the Lakers themselves, sixth in the NBA in fast break points scored. So when they do get stops, they're getting out and running. Points in the paint, the Lakers are third there. But again, that's kind of the same stuff we saw last season. So what's different? What's changed? And part of this is, well, you have to watch the games, right? You got to watch. I know the team is effectively the same, but if you're watching them this season, it's pretty clear they're playing very differently than they did last season. But I thought one key area where it really stands out is with the way the Lakers are defending. So this season, the Lakers, in terms of wide open threes, they're actually pretty good. When you look at how many wide open threes they're giving up to opponents, look at this. You got to go way down the list to find the Lakers. They're firmly middle of the pack with 18 wide open threes given up per game. By the way, 26 wide open threes given up per game by the Memphis Grizzlies. That's a big increase in the high from last season, which was your Los Angeles Lakers gave up almost 22 wide open threes per game last season. Darvin Ham had a defensive scheme where he would try to scheme open, essentially, opponents that he thought were bad shooters. And I didn't particularly agree with that strategy because you're banking on the fact that a 32% three-point shooter is not going to become a 38, 39% three-point shooter if they're left unguarded. And so too often, I thought teams were hitting at a very high percentage. In fact, the Lakers gave up, again, 22 three-pointers that were wide open per game last season, and opponents hit them at a 40% clip. And that was the worst in the NBA last season. You look at this season, the Lakers, the wide open threes that they are giving up, that's been cut down to 18. So you've removed three plus wide open threes per game. And even those shots are only being hit at a 37.6 rate. So right now, they've cleaned that up a little bit. Again, the defense has not been one of their strengths, but that's a significant shift from the way the Lakers were defending last season. They are, I believe, 26th in the NBA this season in defensive rating. Certainly not ideal, not what you want to see out of them. Their offensive rating has been pretty good. Offensively, fifth in the NBA in offensive rating. Defensive rating, yikes, 26th. Again, that's not good. But their defense did get better the last couple of games. Maybe they were playing bad teams. That's certainly part of it. But again, a lot of it, overall, fairly similar to the way the team was last season statistically, but I thought that the wide open threes given up, that's beyond just the eye test, that's a key stat that I think has shifted considerably from last season. Still get to the free throw line a lot. They're hitting a high percentage of their free throws as well. Again, points in the paint are strong. So stylistically, yes, it's different when you watch them play, but they're still kind of producing in similar ways. But let's take a look at the team themselves, at the players, because I think this is where we really need to land with this team, and this is where the focus needs to be. So right now, you take a look at the Lakers roster, and you've got Jared Vanderbilt and Christian Wood out, and so of course that hurts. That hurts in a big way, because this team is simply not deep. You look at this roster right now, and it's just not a deep enough team. You can't withstand injuries to NBA players. And I think that's the biggest criticism of the roster as it stands. And this is why, if there's Lakers fans out there that are feeling negative despite a 6-4 record, this is why. This is why. When you look at the roster and you've got spots, Bronny is taking up a roster spot. He's not an NBA player right now. And I'm not going to get into the whole Bronny debate. I think people are way too polarized on him. Max Lewis, he's not an NBA player right now. And by NBA player, I mean he's not a guy that you could put on the floor and feel confident that he's going to get out there and do the stuff that you need him to do in order to at least stay even in an NBA game. And by the way, Max was really good with the South Bay Lakers the other day. Jalen Hood-Schifino, not a guy you can put on the floor right now. The Lakers didn't even pick up his third-year option. They're probably going to trade him by the trade deadline as an expiring $4 million salary. Hopefully they can turn him into something, because otherwise that is, we're dangerously close to this officially being a completely wasted 17th pick from the draft before last. Gabe Vincent, he did some things last game, but he's amazed with his ability to put up zeros across the board. I mean, look at this. Gabe, no 0.5 offensive rebounds, defensive rebounds 0.7, 0.9 rebounds total, 0.5 assists, 0.6 steals, less than one in everything for Gabe. Not getting to the free throw line. The count now, Gabe does some stuff that doesn't show up on the, I'm not saying that this is the end all be all, but have you gotten $11 million worth of production out of him? No, definitely not. So I think that's really, when we get to this team and we talk about where this team is, because right now, Anthony Davis is maybe the favorite to win MVP. He's certainly playing like an MVP right now. 31 points, 10 and a half boards. Hopefully his eye is okay. 2.8 assists, two blocks. He's been fantastic. He's been phenomenal. And you've got LeBron, who is still producing. He turns 40 next month, and he's averaging 23, 9, and 8. God, that's like, that doesn't even sound real when you say that out loud. 23, 9, and 8, the man turns 40 next month. That's insane. I mean, you got to go back to like Kareem in his final few years. And even he wasn't putting up numbers like that. And so you've got those two guys having really good seasons. You look at Austin, 19 points, 5 assists, 4.5 boards, 1.4 steals, putting up pretty good numbers, producing. So why is this team not better? Why are so many people negative about this team right now? Well, it's because, as I said, you've got multiple guys that aren't producing at an NBA level. And then let's look at who is not giving you production equivalent to their pay. They're not earning their paycheck. D'Angelo Russell. Now, the last couple of games coming off the bench, I think that's changed. So hopefully that's a trend, and that's the way things are going to continue to trend. But D'Angelo Russell on the season so far, not giving you production equal to his pay. 41% from the field, 31% from three. He was a 41%, 42% three-point shooter last season. He was your third best player last season. Again, though, we've seen a spark. Last two games coming off the bench, been different. Hopefully that's a sign of things to come. But D'Lo, overall, is not giving you that production. Rui has fallen off the last few games. What, 4 or 5 games in a row now? Single-digit scoring. The rebounding has dried up. 6 rebounds per game on average now. A big key for the season for Rui was, you're 6'8", got a 7'3 wingspan, got to use it. You have to help on the boards. 2 offensive rebounds per game, I'll take that. But Rui had a few games at the beginning of the season where you thought, okay, JJ's unlocked Rui, here we go. He put up 20 and 10 against Phoenix. And then since then, single-digit scoring every game and either 4 or 5 rebounds every game. That's not enough for a guy who's playing 34 minutes. So is he living up to his contract? Probably a little bit below his current contract value. Jackson Hayes, yeah, actually he has. He's given you energy off the bench, and that's all you can ask for from him. I think he's done a really nice job. And on a minimum contract, I can't say anything bad about Jackson Hayes. Dalton Connect, he's a rookie. He's been up and down. That's what you expect from a rookie, though. The Lakers, unfortunately, because of the spot that they're in, they're reliant upon Dalton Connect to play minutes for them every single night because they don't have the depth. Cam Reddish has earned his way into the starting five in part because he's been good, but also in part because Max Christie, who they paid over the summer, has been awful. Haven't been able to play him. He is now out of the rotation. So think about that from a salary perspective. And once again, I'm not super negative on the Lakers right now. Not super down on them. 6-4, I'll take it. But why is this team not better? Well, look at what's happening. Look at the guys that you paid to be major pieces. D'Lo, Rui. Austin's been great. But LeBron, AD, well, I should say Austin's been good. He's gotten picked on a little bit defensively. LeBron and AD have been great. D'Lo, Rui, Gabe, Vando, Max, JHS. That's a lot of guys that I just named in your top paid players that right now are either not playable. Max and JHS, you can't put it into an NBA game right now. Or are producing well below what their paycheck would suggest they should. That's why. That's why the Lakers are right now not a contender, because you've got guys that you're paying to give you more that are simply not. And so that's going to be a problem for the Lakers to solve. And hopefully it's a problem that can solve itself to a degree. Hopefully Gabe gets going and suddenly he's playing like an $11 million player. Hopefully Jared Vanderbilt comes back and he's healthy and he looks like the Jared Vanderbilt that we remembered from last year, that we remembered in that first half against Boston right before he got hurt, when he was everywhere. That's the guy. If he's doing that, he's worth the $10 million bucks you're paying him. So this isn't a static thing, but why are the Lakers not better despite LeBron and AD playing so well? Because so much of the rest of the supporting cast has not quite lived up to expectations. Again, we're 10 games in. That can certainly change. And overall, I'm not too unhappy with the way this team is playing right now or where they're at. I also think, you know, JJ Redick had some comments recently. In fact, JJ, after the win over the Raptors, JJ Redick, D'Angelo Russell, Austin Reeves, all talked about the guys buying in and how important that buy-in is. And I did a video on that yesterday for the Lakers Nation YouTube channel. And I had some people that commented, you know, saying, oh, this is ridiculous. You know, the Lakers just won two games against bad teams. Who cares? That doesn't mean anything. Why are you getting all excited? I think there's a misconception. I think people are confused. Being bought in, which I do think this team is, does not mean they're suddenly a juggernaut, does not mean they are suddenly unstoppable and they're going to just dominate the NBA. Okay, now here it is. They're bought in, so they're a contender. No, don't hear what I'm not saying. I think they are bought in. And by bought in, I mean that they believe in the tactics and the strategies that the coaching staff is giving to them. D'Angelo Russell has not said a single negative word in a contract year. He got moved to the bench and he's not said a single negative word. All he's done is talk about how he wants to make sure that he does everything he can to help the team win. And you give the man credit. That's buy-in. The coach asked you to do something. That's not the best thing for D'Lo. That's not the best thing for his wallet. But D'Angelo Russell says, all I want to do is help this team win. That's buy-in. That's buy-in. I think we're seeing the team buy in. Now, would we like them to be better in transition? Absolutely. Their transition defense needs to get better. We saw them, though, in the second half against the Raptors. Clean up the boards. They got better in transition. That's not to say the problem is solved, but I do think they're listening to the coaches. I think they believe in JJ Redick and the staff and what they're providing. So there's buy-in. That doesn't mean they're great, though. I think this team believes in this coaching staff. And that's a great place to be in compared to last season when that was not the case. But the bottom line is they need guys to produce. They need guys to produce if they're going to get to where they want to go. We all know a trade, if not trades, are probably coming. Sometime between now and February, when we hit the trade deadline, moves are coming. People will roll their eyes and say, yeah, that's what we said last year at the trade deadline. That's what we said over the summer. I get it. But we know, ultimately, to get where they want to go, this team needs to make some moves. And they need some of these guys to step up and produce at a level that their salary would suggest that they should. You do that, and this team's right there. And this team's right there. I believe that. This team's right there if you can get enough production out of the guys that you paid to produce and make a move or two, frankly. All right, let me know in the comment section, how do you feel about where the Lakers are at right now? Overall, I'm not upset with 6-4. Overall, I'm optimistic while recognizing that this team's being held back by the guys that you paid to produce not really producing at the level you need them to, and being kept afloat by the brilliance of Anthony Davis, by the incredible play of LeBron James. These things are lifting the team up to the current status that they're at. So give me your thoughts on where they're at right now in the comments section. Do you agree with me? Am I overly optimistic? Am I overly pessimistic? Let me know in the comments section. I do need to get into the mailbag. I have a few spicy things to get into there. We'll get into that in just a moment. Today's show is brought to you by Skims. When I first heard that Skims was making men's underwear, I wasn't really sure what to think. I'm pretty particular about my underwear. It's got to be extremely versatile. It has to offer flexibility for when I'm going for runs, walks, lifting weights, all of that, while also staying comfortable when I'm just sitting in a seat for long periods of time, which I do here covering the Los Angeles Lakers. And I'm happy to say that after trying them out, Skims is extremely soft, extremely comfortable. I tried the 5-inch boxer briefs, and they also allowed plenty of flexibility in the gym. In fact, it feels like you're wearing gym clothes for the rest of your day when you're wearing Skims underwear. So I've been really, really pleased with them and would definitely recommend that you guys check them out. Again, extremely comfortable, and above all else for me, extremely versatile. Go check out skims.com. And when you get there, after you place your order on the drop down menu, tell them that you came from us, from the Lakers Nation podcast. Select Lakers Nation from the drop down menu. Again, tell them that we sent you. That's skims.com. Go check them out. All right, let's get into the mailbag. And we'll start with this. These were coming in from the post game, Lakers versus Raptors. Need Bron to get going in these first halves with AD. If he can't, then go get Zach. Relying on Austin Reeves, Cam, Rui won't work long term. JJ, good coaching second half. Okay, so go get Zach LaVine. That's who he's talking about. And Zach LaVine last night against the Cavs looked pretty good. Looked like a professional scorer. Let's say that. 12 of 20 shooting, Zach LaVine. 2 of 7 from 3, that's not great, but 6 boards, 3 assists, 26 points. He was a plus 16 for Chicago. You know, Zach LaVine, we've said it all along, he's a talented player. I've been talking about this for a while. He is, on the season, 22 points, 5 boards, 3.3 assists, 43% from 3. That's probably going to come down a little bit, but 43% from 3, 51% from the field. He's a good player. He's a good basketball player, and he is a he is one of the prime examples of what can happen when a player's value relative to their contract gets confused with them on the basketball court and what they actually produce. Is Zach LaVine a good basketball player? Yes. Does Zach LaVine help your team win? Yes. Is he worth $43 million? No. That's the problem. That's where people get caught up and they start to take the frustration with this contract and let that bleed through into their analysis of him as a basketball player. He's a very good player, but you still have the same problem that we've been talking about all summer, that if you're going to trade for Zach LaVine, you're probably stacking up two contracts at least that I don't know if you want to stack up D'Lo, Rui, and then we're probably talking Gabe Vincent. Now I know D'Lo's not been great this season so far. He is going to be, we're going to hear a million trades between now and February that all involve D'Angelo Russell. He's on an expiring contract, and it's pretty clear the Lakers are going to be exploring the trade market with him. Rui Hachimura, can you move a wing right now with how thin this team is on the wing? If they still had Torian Prince, maybe you'd feel a little bit better doing that, but they're very thin at the 4 right now and the 5. Can you turn Rui into a shooting guard in Zach LaVine? I don't know. Again, Zach's a very good player. I think the Lakers are going to make a move or moves. I don't know if he's the guy. I'm still not sold on him being the guy. He's a very talented scorer. I think he would help the Lakers, but this is already a team that's lacking a lot of depth, and you'd probably have to give up a decent amount of it to get him. Now, the upside is, unlike most of the other players that we talk about on the market, because his contract is bad, you can probably get him without having to include any draft capital. Or let's put it this way, you should get him without having to include any draft capital. So that preserves some flexibility for another move down the road, potentially. Something to keep in mind. Alicia said, Master Lock Pirtle. Yeah, Jakob Pirtle. Good player. I wouldn't mind seeing him next to AD if the Lakers do pull off a trade for a big. But the eye poke to Anthony Davis that knocked AD out of the game, caught LeBron with an elbow. Not good when you're injuring the Lakers' top two stars. Dondre said, JHS remove protections on a first. Oh, on the 2027 first, plus a first for Walker Kessler. I mean, that would probably be the deal, right? Is that enough? Should the Lakers do that? You know, I like Walker Kessler a lot. I do wonder what the opportunity cost looks like. Like, what's the price to get Jakob Poeltl? What's the price to get Clint Capella? Now, these guys are not nearly as young as Kessler. They don't have the upside that Kessler does, but they have experience. Talented players, probably more game-by-game dependable than Walker Kessler would be. And let's remember, Kessler's going to have to get paid. He's going to need a new contract. On the season, I'm not trying to present too much of an argument against him, because I do like Walker Kessler a lot, but 9.2 rebounds, 10.7 boards, 2.8 blocks. He's killing it. He's putting up great numbers. 69% from the field. Nice. Walker Kessler's getting it done for Utah. So I think if that deal was on the table, I'd be sorely tempted to take that for the Lakers. Now, that giving up that 1-4 protection in 2027, the potential is there for that to really come back to bite you, because you have to imagine LeBron's gone by that point. So that could really hurt. It could, but I do like Walker Kessler a lot. Then Max Gabe, so Max Chris, we're trading Max Chris, said after December 15th, Max Gabe in 3 seconds for Bogdanovich from Atlanta. Got it. Yeah. I mean, he's better than Max. He's better than Gabe. I like him a lot. 3 seconds is a lot, but without having the contract in front of me, yeah, I'd probably do that. Add a player off the buyout market, and then your team would be Reeves, Cam Reddish, LeBron, Rui, AD, D'Lo, Bogdanovich, Vando, Kessler, Wood, Connect, Hayes if needed. Yeah, that's a pretty good team. It's a pretty good team. Now, you would still have another first to potentially play with on the market. But, and would Atlanta do Bogdanovich without getting a first? Fair to ask. But that's, I guess, bigger picture, and that's really where we should go with this rather than focus too much on the trade itself. That's kind of what I'm expecting from the Lakers. I'm not expecting the big, oh my gosh, the Lakers got Giannis. Like, that would be great, but I'm not expecting that type of move from the Lakers. I'm thinking more what we saw the Mavs do last year. PJ Washington, Daniel Gafford, get a couple guys like that. Walker Kessler, Bogdanovich would certainly fit the bill. I do think the two skill sets they need the big, and then they need a two-way wing. I think those are the two things they need the most. And so that can be, you know, Bogdanovich doesn't necessarily check that box, but I'm a big fan of his game, so I'd have a hard time saying no on that. All right, we'll do a few more. Mixmaster Mike said, Boucher gets my master lock for imitating Devin Booker with the falling down after every shot. So annoying. That is really, it's one of my pet peeves in today's NBA. Guys who shoot jumpers, and Jay Crowder was the worst at this, but guys who fall down every time they shoot a jumper. You know, I saw something earlier last night that James Harden has the record for the most four-point plays. Hit a three and one. But it's because he falls on every single three-point attempt, almost, right? He looks to create contact on his shot and then fall down. Devin Booker does that too. And Chris Boucher did it as well on a three-point. I actually got a technical for flopping, which was great. Bravo, referees. Let's do more of this. Get rid of this BS, I'm going to fall down every time I shoot a jumper thing. It should be embarrassing for these guys to keep doing this. Fall down, you shoot it. Now, it's one thing if a player puts his foot under you and is trying to hurt you. That's different. But these guys that are trying to make it look like there's contact on a jump shot by falling down, it makes it look like that's what they do. Like they practice not landing on their feet when they're shooting a jump shot because they're trying to make it look like they got contact. We see more closeouts than ever before in today's NBA because offenses are getting better and better and better at creating open threes. So there's more players rushing at three-point shooters. And the response we've seen from the shooters is, for some of them anyway, is to try to pretend like they get hit. Because it can be a valuable thing. A four-point play or three free throws, that's an extremely valuable thing to happen. But I would like to see the referees then step up. And when there is no contact, give them that flopping tech like they did to Boucher the other night. Love it. TikTok exposed. So, Trevor, are you liberal or conservative? Okay, so I don't want to spend a ton of time on this, but here's where I ultimately fall with all of the political stuff. I don't specify whether I lean to the right or lean to the left. I don't. And there's some reason for that. Do I have my own thoughts on politics? Yes. I was a political science and history major. I think that politics are fascinating. I think the way it all plays out, I think the spin that both sides try to put on things can be interesting to watch and follow along with. But I'm not here to talk about politics. This is not a politics channel. And so in this case, I don't want to get into my own political beliefs because that's not what people are here for. That's not what the people listening to this show or watching this show are here for. You guys are here for basketball. And there are a lot of people who use sports as some time away from all of that. We get bombarded, especially during an election year. We get bombarded with political stuff nonstop. And sometimes it's nice to have a safe haven away from that. And so because of that, like if this were a political channel, it's totally different. Then yeah, I'd be sharing my thoughts on politics and all of that. But that's not what people are here for. And on top of that, politics can be so divisive and so polarizing that, and I don't like that it's this way. I wish that we were more accepting of each other's political thinkings and understanding that people can disagree with us. But it's so divisive that it would, I think, derail some of our conversation. Again, I don't want to talk politics. I'm here to talk basketball. So I know that if we opened Pandora's box and started to talk politics, our conversations about basketball would invariably get hit with, again, this is a very interactive show, would invariably get derailed by political stuff. And I don't want that. It's not what I'm here for. I'm here to talk basketball. So that's why I don't specify. And also part of it stems from my time as a teacher, where I firmly believe that, or at least my philosophy as a teacher was that I wanted kids to leave my classroom having no idea what my thoughts on politics were. Because I believe that my job as a teacher was to teach kids to think, not teach kids what I think. And I know that sentiment in general is more of a right-wing-esque talking point right now, but that was my approach to teaching for 13 years in the classroom. And I think I was successful in that. I went in every year with the goal of the kids leaving my classroom at the end of the year and not knowing what my thoughts on politics were. So some of that sentiment, I think, transfers into this too, just for different reasons. But I'm very used to not sharing my political opinions publicly. I don't think it's productive in this space. It's not what I want to spend my time talking about. And then coming from my teaching background, it was something that I thought was important because I wanted my students to think for themselves and not for my own opinions to a captive audience, right? In teaching, to influence them. So all of that is wrapped up in my answer to this question to say, I'm not going to tell you whether I lean to the right, lean to the left, or any of that. I have thoughts on politics, but it's not something that I want to spend my time discussing, and especially not here because it's not why people are here. All right, Avi B said, been a while, I'm back. Welcome back, Avi B. Reeves just gets better each game. Patience, foul drawing, outside shot, defense. Also, Dalton Connect is a pure shooter. His misses look good too. Yeah, I mean, Austin's been good. Austin did get picked on a bunch in that Detroit game. Jaden Ivey really went at him, and that was an issue. But overall, I think Austin's defense has improved. I think D'Angelo Russell's gotten picked on a bit more than Austin. There's still a lot of weakness overlaps between those two players. But Austin was great. He was great in this last game against the Raptors. Really helped keep the Lakers afloat and helped secure the win when Anthony Davis went out. And then Dalton Connect, yeah, he just needs time. He's a rookie. He needs time to get his legs under him. And on top of that, he's a rookie. So inherent with rookies is there's going to be a lot of up and down play. You're going to ride the roller coaster. There's not a lot of consistency because everything that they're seeing is brand new. They haven't experienced the NBA before. So all the stuff, you know, this team's running sets a certain way. They have to defend certain things from Team X, and then the next night against Team Y, it's totally different. They haven't gone through all of that yet. So there's not a lot of consistency in general with rookies game to game. But on top of that, he's a rookie where a lot of his value comes from shooting. Well, shooting is probably the least sticky of stats, right? Where if a guy's a good rebounder, typically they're going to get rebounds every single night, right? Some nights will be more than others, but they're going to rebound every single night. If a guy's a good three-point shooter and he gets six attempts a game, there'll be nights where he shoots 0 for 6. There'll be nights where he shoots 4 or 5 out of 6. And you're going to have that game to game. There's going to be that variance. So on top of the fact that he's a rookie, you're going to get these up and down performances from Dalton Connect because his primary skill set right now is as a scorer. There's just inherently, particularly as a shooter too, there's inherently a lot of variance there with that. So I do like Dalton. I like what we've seen so far from him. He's been in a bit of a slump, but with all great shooters, they are one game away, the next shot away from starting a scoring streak. So yeah, do not count Dalton Connect out. All right. Mob mentality, Raps willing to trade quickly or RJ if they tank? I don't think so. I think they are building around those two guys. RJ Barrett and Emmanuel Quickley have been great for them. And those were the pieces they got back in their big trade with the Knicks last year. So I think they're gonna hang on to those guys. Diego said, trade idea. The Hawks receive Gabe Vando JHS along with a 2026 first and a 2025 second. And the Lakers receive Clint Capella. I wouldn't do that from the Lakers side. I'm not the biggest Clint Capella fan in the world. I think he would help the Lakers, but I still am holding out hope that Jared Van. Now you're clearing, like, Gabe Vincent is negative value right now. So there's some added value there. I just don't know if Capella is the guy that I'd be willing to surrender Vando plus a first to go get. Like, if you told me it was a couple of seconds, Gabe Vando. Now maybe the Hawks don't want to take on long-term salary, so there's that too, but I don't know if I would do that. Senpai said, how long do we give Rui? In fact, I think I'd be exploring other options rather than go and give that up for Capella. If I'm giving up a first, I want to make sure. And by the way, their 2026 first is not tradable because the 2027 first is already traded. So, but call it the 2029 first if you want. I don't think Capella is the piece that I would give up a first for. Senpai said, how long do we give Rui becoming a trend? I hope he can bounce back. I hope he did get sick. I hope the illness had something to do with it, but he has indeed struggled of late, and the Lakers do need him back on track. They really, really do. He's just not been, the last five games or so, has not been producing the way that he did to start the season. And I hope that he does get back on track and he gets back on track real soon. The positive thing, I'll tell you guys this. I was in Memphis covering the game the other day. And before the game, the PA announcer in Memphis, I was out on the court and they're talking to the crowd and talking about, you know, previewing the game, and said, Rui Hachimura is out tonight for the Lakers. Thank goodness, because he tends to have really big performances against the Grizzlies. And he's not wrong. So my hope is that tomorrow's game against Memphis, this is the team that Rui tends to play well against. Hopefully this will be a get right game for him and it's going to get him back on track. But Lakers Nation, went over a lot on today's show. Let me know your comments in the comment section on the YouTube channel or over on the Apple Podcast side when you give us a 5-star rating and review. Again, thank you everybody for joining the show. Super chat questions, the mailbag. I will get to the rest of them on tomorrow's show when we preview Lakers versus Grizzlies. Till next time, everybody. See ya and stay safe.